Welcome to the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth. Wherever you are on your faith journey, we are glad that you are here, worshiping with us together as we seek the face of Christ and as we love each other. Let us join together in worship. Through the season of Advent, please join us in beginning our worship services with prayer and contemplation, observing the incense that thickens the air, reminding us that the Holy Spirit is with us. Observe the lit candles on the Advent wreath. Help us mark time as we anticipate Christ's new birth in our hearts and our lives. Join in the singing of the Tese refrain that calls our attention to the ongoing need for justice and peace for all God's children. Blessed are you, O God. You sent your Son to be the light of the world and to spread his light of love to all. Bless us and accept this wreath of light lit by our hands. May its ever-increasing brightness be a sign of the approaching nearness of your Son, that we might prepare in joy for his humble birth in the manger and be ready to receive him at his coming again in glory. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first Advent candle represents the hope we have in the promise of Christ's presence with us. God's promise will be fulfilled to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. A righteous branch will spring up from David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of oppression and put on the armor of justice. Now, in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that, in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you and your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not exceedingly be angry. O Lord, do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the people.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read the psalm in unison. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who are enthroned upon the cherubim, shine forth. Before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh, stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with your people's prayers? You have fed them with the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in full measure. You make us the scorn of our neighbors. Our enemies laugh among themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved. They have burned it with fire. They have cut it down. May they perish at the rebuke of your countenance. But let your hand be upon the one on your right hand, the one whom you made strong for yourself. Then we will never turn back from you. Give us life, and we will call on your name.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Israel. Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Christ. Jesus said, "In those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey, when he leaves and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at the cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all. Keep awake." This is the gospel of the Lord. One of the most important reasons we observe the seasons of a liturgical year in the Episcopal Church is that they ask us to consider our faith and the living of our lives outside of ourselves. Each season brings with it new colors and a new focus. Liturgical seasons save us from molding our faith into a reflection of our own wants and desires. The season of Advent, which begins today, challenges us to consider our faith and lifestyles within the framework of anticipating the coming of Christ. This includes reflecting on how we experience God breaking into our daily lives. And as we near Christmas Day, it will include reflecting on how the coming of Christ once took shape in a baby in Bethlehem. Advent is all about anticipating that which is not yet fulfilled, anticipating the final coming of the Messiah in glory to fulfill the ancient destiny of the world and all who live in it. As we examine our faith within the framework of Advent, we ask what it takes to live faithfully in the world between now and then. This is an especially important question at this time of year, because if ever we are to be aware of the conflict between the aspirations of the consumerist society around us and the gospel call for simplicity and service to the poor, this is it. Typically, clergy call their congregations to do this work through imagery of light and darkness. Advent is when preachers remind congregations that the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness does not overcome it. This phrase elicits hope. It reminds us that no matter how bleak things may get, God will always offer a spark of light to guide us through the short days of winter and the difficult, downright depressing times in which we find ourselves right now. We preachers like to talk about light and darkness because it comes straight from Scripture. This imagery is used throughout both the Old and the New Testaments. However, the Hebrew and Greek words for light and dark clearly refer to the presence or absence of a source of illumination. The word for light refers to the glorious presence of the sun or fire, while dark refers to the night or shadows, which are both to be avoided. In the Hebrew account of Genesis's first creation story, God says, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, and that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day and the darkness night. Again, this Hebrew word for light specifically describes a thing which illuminates, whether it's describing a giant ball of light in the sky or the tiny flicker within a candle flame. It's the same word. The same goes for the Greek words used in the Gospels. Light refers to things that illuminate. Our gospel lesson today begins with Jesus saying, "In those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light." A translation from the Greek could read, "The sun will be obscured and the moon will not glimmer." It's all about the light that the sun and the moon give off, or don't give off. This imagery works in Hebrew and Greek, but it no longer works for us today. A problem arises in our English language because we use light and dark not only when talking about illumination, but also when describing tone and color and pigmentation. A problem arises when we read over and over and over in Scripture that light is desirable and darkness is something to be avoided. A problem arises because we use Holy Scripture to send the message that light skin tones are desirable while dark skin tones are not. Language matters. Language shapes our views of the world both explicitly and implicitly. What messages do clergy send when every year we spend the season of Advent preparing for the coming of Christ with the reminder that light shines in darkness, but darkness will not overtake it? What messages do we send to our friends of color when every year we use dark to mean bad and light to mean good? This would be unacceptable anywhere, but especially here in a country with centuries-long history of racially based slavery, a country still governed by the ideology of white supremacy. Our friends of color come to our churches where we affirm their personhood and name them as created in the image of God, only to receive the message then that their dark skin tones should be pushed away by lighter ones. For those of us who are white, this message surely distorts the perception that we hold of ourselves when we regularly hear that light prevails over dark, when we hear that light is often a symbol of God. For those of us who are white, this idea may not have ever registered for us before, which, of course, is another example of white privilege. I hadn't thought about it until the Reverend Dr. Will Gaffney raised the issue during a clergy meeting earlier this year. She wondered aloud about the imagery of moving out of darkness. And then I read a book she recommended by the Reverend Lenny Duncan called Dear Church. I now know that this imagery stings our friends of color when they hear it. And if something we do inflicts pain, then we must address it. We must change. This season of Advent, we're doing just that. We are growing our awareness of racial injustice in the church and in our lives. Through the guidance of our Diocese of Fort Worth Working Group on Racial Justice and Reparations, this Advent, we are asking you to enter this work of wholeness and healing. Rather than looking away from the multitude of sins in our collective past and shying away from the prevalent of injustices in our present, we are asking you to look directly at the pain our church has caused, that we have caused. This is the invitation that the Reverend Robert Pace issued during the working group's report at our annual diocesan convention on November 14th. We won't immediately unveil all the racist language, images, or biases within our churches and within ourselves, but we absolutely must commit to doing this work. We can continue growing in our awareness. We can repent. We can do better. In the words we use and in our behaviors, we can proclaim to all God's children that they are holy, beloved by God who made each one of us in all of our diversities. This first Sunday of Advent, we're no longer asking you to cast out darkness and embrace the light. Instead, as we prayed at the beginning of the service, we are praying that God gives us grace to cast away the works of oppression, that we might put on the armor of justice. We have much work to do.
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray, saying, Christ, have mercy. For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, Scott, our bishop, and for all bishops, ministers, and lay leaders, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For Donald, our president, Joe, our president-elect, Greg, our governor, Betsy, our mayor, all who are in command in the military, and for all first responders, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For healthcare providers and support staff worldwide and the patients in their care, for the aged and infirm, for refugees and victims, for the sick and suffering, and for those we now name. Let us pray, Christ have mercy. For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection and for all the departed, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray, Christ have mercy. In the communion of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, Let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to God.
To thee, Almighty God. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
A blessing for your Advent journey. May the God of hope fill you. May the God of joy overflow you. May the God of peace pour you into the world. May God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, bless and keep you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to seek justice for all God's children.
Thanks be to God.